Good morning and welcome to Travis Baptist this morning. We had a little bit of a power issue this morning, so the outlets on this side of the sanctuary aren't working. So you see a cable running across, so if you come forward, be careful of the cable that's running. Because if you knock that out, you knock out the computer, you knock out this TV. So just be careful if you come up. So Larry says he's going to start troubleshooting that tomorrow. So, huh? Oh, and if you see the emergency lights are on, it's because they're They're tied into the power outlets. So ignore the emergency lights. We got them turned so they're not blinding everybody over here, because if they were in the normal position, everybody over here would be sitting there looking at this blinding white light. So, and you wouldn't be going to heaven at that point. So we're here to worship the Lord, so let's go ahead and stand and sing, "He is Exalted."
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise Him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise Him. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise Him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and I will praise Him. Exalted on high.
Today's scripture reading is from 2 Corinthians 12:7-10. And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure.
Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength made perfect in weakness."
Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in percussions, in distresses, for Christ's sake.
For when I am weak, then I am strong.
Let's pray together. We love you, Lord, and it is so good to know that in our deepest trials, in the chaos of life, in the circle and swirling problems that come our way, that the world throws everything at us, you are there. Not only that, you're there, Lord, when we are without hope, when we're without strength, when we've got nothing left, there's your strength. There you are holding us up, lifting us up, pulling us through. God, it is good to know that you will never leave us or forsake us. Today, as we gather to worship you, Lord, we pray that everyone here, whatever struggles they're going through, will realize what a wonderful thing it is to have a relationship with the living God, and that this is possible through your Son, Jesus Christ, because you died for us, Jesus, and you rose from the grave, that whoever believes
would not perish. So God, we are grateful, and we're praying for each one here today. You know our hearts. You know our struggles. Speak to us. Lift us up. Hold us tight. Bring us in closer. Do what needs to be done, Lord, so that we might truly be all that you've called us to be. We say all these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. It is time. It's Vacation Bible School time. We've been talking about it for months. It starts tomorrow. We've got 42 kids registered online, and we will have more probably walk-ins tomorrow. So registration tables are going to be open at 5:30. We will be in here in the sanctuary by 6:15, and we will be kicking it off. So come and join us. Be in much prayer this afternoon for the kids, for their families, that God will work in a lot of ways. Yes, it's going to be hot this week, but then it's Texas, so there you go. And so just be in much prayer for all of that. If you are serving, be sure that you're on time. The devil is going to come up with all kinds of little things to make you run late, to distract you, to discourage you. Just keep coming. Keep pushing. Be there where you've committed to be, and God will bless, all right? So that is this week. Kids kindergarten, who finished kindergarten up through finishing sixth grade, are the ones we're taking. So just come on, and we are looking forward to a great week. That means that's the only thing going on this week, all right? We don't have Wednesday night Bible study. We don't have anything else, but we are having Bible school this week. Next Sunday is Father's Day. We want to remember that. And I want to encourage you dads. We got a couple special things happening next week, including we really got you a good gift this year. So it's not a tie. It's not a pin. So there we go. Make you wonder. Okay? And then Wednesday the 22nd, not this Wednesday, the next one, is going to be our monthly potluck. We're doing that because my family and I are going to be out from end of June through July the 4th. So please remember us in your prayers. We still have room for folks to serve, particularly as shepherds, in our First Blessing Ministry that will be occurring August 13th. Just like Bible school eventually got here, so will August 13th. So as you think and pray, please get yourself ready to go. Pray about maybe God could use you in one of those spots. Shepherds are very important because you're the members from the church that these people get to meet the most and spend the most time with. So please consider this. And we've got a few other openings, of course, with First Blessing. There are sign-up sheets out on the little brown table out in the foyer. Keeping all that stuff in mind, okay? We are glad you're here. If you're with us for the first time or the first time in a while, we have a little card on here on our bulletin. If you fill that out and drop it in the offering plate, we will try and get more information to you about the church. Didn't manage to do it last week. We'll try real hard this week, okay, if we missed you last week. But please do so. Also, if you're a regular here and you just need to update addresses, emails, phone numbers, anything like that, please use this little form. It tears right off, and you can drop it in the offering plate when it comes by later. We are glad you're here today. So let's go around and welcome one another into the Lord's house. Hey there. How are you, Ellen?
Good.
Hey there, ma'am. How are you? Howdy, how are you? Leo, how are you doing? Oh. Hey, y'all. How's everybody? Miss Jasmine? Martha, how are you? Yeah. 6 months old?
Yes.
6 months old? We're going to have to start planning a birthday party pretty soon.
Yeah.
Yep. Hello, young, how are you?
Good.
Okay. All right. Oh, look at her. Hi, baby. Oh.
as we make it back to our places. Run, Donna, run. As we make it back to our places, we will be standing. And join with me as we sing As the Deer.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You desire, and I long to worship thee. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
At this time, the children may be excused to head on up to children's church. As they go out, the rest of us will sing The Wonder of It All.
There's the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder as sunrise I see. But the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me. There's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun. But the wonder think that God loves me.
Please be seated.
All right. It's time for us to pray together at our family prayer time. We have many needs, we realize. You may or may not know Miss Esmeralda Uribe. Her sister passed away this weekend. We want to keep that family in prayer. And of course, the Bible school this week, all the kids, all the families that will be joining us, be praying that God will move mightily among them. And also we have others who are struggling, others who are going through things. And so lift each other up. Remember to pray without ceasing. Our altar is open. If you would like to come up here and pray, you may. Brother Ralph is here if you want to pray with one of our deacons, someone to pray with you. And let's take this time now to open up our hearts to just say to the Lord, this is everything going on, all my mess, all my failure, all my sin, all my struggle. Here it is, Lord. Let's pray. Our Lord and our God, you alone can cleanse our sin. You alone can heal our wounds. You alone can cause us to prosper. You can also chastise us. You can also hold us back. You can also send us through trials and tribulations that we don't think we can survive. But in all of those things, Lord, the good and what we perceive as being bad, you are exalted in all of it. You are able to work in us and through us. We get confused sometimes thinking it all ought to be happy and it all ought to be simple. But life is not like that. Sin has damaged this world and contaminated it. And yet you still come into all our filth and all our failure. And you redeem us. And you walk with us, and you move us forward, and you work all things together for good for those that love you. And Lord, we want to say today, we love you. We love you, and we don't understand what's happening sometimes, but we're going to love you despite it all. And we're going to trust that there's going to come a day we do understand why you sent us down this path. Little things that are annoying, big things that are tragic, confusing things that leave us befuddled and wondering, what are you doing, God? What is it you expect from us? But through it all, your light shines brightly. Through it all, you take us down these paths and through the narrow gates and over the mountains and down into the valleys, through the fire and through the flood, and into your everlasting abode. Oh God, it is beautiful. It is beautiful what you're doing in our lives. Help us to trust the process by which you make us more and more like your Son. We pray today for those who are struggling with health. We pray for Patty and Hazel, Lord, in their therapy. We're asking, God, that you continue to heal and bless. We're grateful for Tom, Lord, that you brought him through a struggle this week, and we ask you, God, to continue healing. We pray, Lord, for these kids coming to Bible school this week. that their hearts are open to your word, that our workers will be representing Jesus Christ in the most wonderful, plain way possible, that when they see the smiles, when they are in the presence of those who are serving them, they will know this is where Christ is, and that a hunger and thirst will develop in their young hearts for you, Lord, for knowing the security that they'll always be with you. For their parents, Lord, that the kids will come home every night telling stories of what happened here, that they too might realize maybe there's a place here for them. We know there is. There's a place for everybody at your table, Lord. For all who will call upon that name, all who will turn from their sin, there's a spot. And so we pray today, Lord, for them, that each of these families might come closer, that this might be the time that they as a family might start belonging to your church, your people. Fathers and mothers repenting and calling upon your name, leading their children in your ways. God, this is our goal. Nothing short of that. So Lord, we pray, do a great work, Lord. Open their eyes, their hearts. Bless those who will be serving and teaching and performing and doing all the deeds that have to be done this week. And we pray for this church, Lord. Let her light shine brightly. Be powerful through the members of this church, Lord. Speak through them, work through them, bless through them. As we go to work, as we go to school, as we go wherever it is you lead us, that those we come in contact will know that there is a risen Savior. That they will know you make a difference in our lives. Help us share your story, Lord. Bless these people. Bless this city. And we ask it all in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sometimes we go through struggles and we don't know why. Sometimes we get through struggles and we learn something through it and we realize why we had gone through that. Other times we've got no clue, and years pass and we never know. And sometimes we go through things that we won't know why we went through them until we're up in heaven with God. That's what this next song's about. We will understand it better by and by.
Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God would lead us to that blessed promised land. But He'll guide us with His eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Oft our cherished plans have failed, disappointments have prevailed, and we wandered in the darkness, heavy-hearted and alone. But we're trusting in the Lord, and according to His word, we will understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Temptations, hidden snares often take us unaware, and our hearts are made to bleed for some thoughtless word or deed. And we wondered why the test when we try to do our best, but we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the are gathered home, we will tell the story, how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by.
Let's go ahead and stand for our offering as we sing, open my eyes that I may see.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my heart the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth out this clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my ears, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my mouth and let it bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my heart, illumine me, Spirit divine.
Will you pray with me, church? Heavenly Father, it's a privilege to come to your house of worship and worship you and honor you and glorify your name. Take these tithes, dear Lord, that we can extend your kingdom and that we can just spread the good news that lead to everlasting life through your Son. Heavenly Father, forgive us when we sin against you, dear Lord, and we appreciate all the things that you do for us, and use us, dear Lord, that we can just tell people about your story. And of course, we ask you all these things through your mighty Son, our Lord and Savior and Redeemer, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
All right, if you have your Bibles with you, would you open them to Romans chapter 8? Continuing our series from the 8th chapter of Romans about life in the Spirit. And one of the great chapters of the Bible, one of my favorites, the kind of thing where if you're stuck on a desert island, you can only have one chapter from the Bible. This might be it for some of us. It tells us so much, gives us so much encouragement and help in the things that are happening and how to cope with life. And knowing that we're not alone in this battle, that we are in fact filled by God's Spirit, empowered by Him, and able to do all things through Christ. So, we're going to be in Romans. We're going to be talking today about verses 28 through 30. That's where we will be reading. Romans verses, chapter 8, verses 28 through 30. And talking today about God's big picture of purpose. And so let us stand, please, for the reading of God's Word. Romans chapter 8, verse 28, down to verse 30. Romans 8, 28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, when He predestined, whom He predestined, these He also called. And whom He called, these He also justified. And whom He justified, these He also glorified. Let's pray. Thank You, Lord. Thank You that we have confidence in You. That while life can be confusing, You're not. We may not understand everything, but You lay it out there for us. Our finite minds can't capture everything of the wonderful, infinite Father we have. But we know this, that You love us, that You're working on our behalf, and that if You're for us, nobody can be against us. And we love this about You. And we say these things in Your most holy name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. So life, it gets crazy. The pendulum keeps swinging around here. We've gone from the shootings in Uvalde and in Buffalo, and now we've got a man walking down the street trying to get close to the house of a Supreme Court justice to assassinate him. We're living in a world that people, just no matter what decision gets made, they're planning to start a riot about it. We're in the middle of Pride Month. We're in the middle of every company out there letting us know how they support homosexual rights and all of these things spinning all around us. As God's people, where do we go? Because in our own lives, we see all this on the outside. Then we look at our lives and it's just as chaotic there. It's just as confusing. Marriages that are struggling, children that are rebellious, people at work that are not doing their jobs. We're wondering where the next dollar may come from. And then when you stop at the gas station on the way home, you think tithing at church is bad. You got to tithe there also. You need to leave that offering for the people out there at Valero and make sure they've got enough at these gas prices. All of it, and where is it going? Maybe our nation is under judgment. We need to prayerfully consider that. That we have disobeyed God for too long, we have ignored Him for too long, and that we need to be careful and realize we may have just reaped what we may have just sowed what we've been reaping for decades. But in all of it, does that mean we're on our own? No, because we know right here in verse 28, all things work together for good for those who love God. Amen. Yeah, they do. What looks bad to me, God works for good. What looks tragic and devastating to you, God's going to use in a way to build you back up. We can give you all sorts of motivational phrases here, like, you know, what doesn't kill you just makes you stronger. That all these bad things, all these things help to build us back up and make us stronger into what He wants us to be. God uses every circumstance, this verse tells us, and works it for good. In your grief and in your pain, you often are going, how can this possibly be good? There's a whole lot of people in Uvalde who probably ask that question every day right now. But through it all, we realize our God is doing something good. It may not feel good. We may not look at it and say, this was good. But what it says is he works them together for good. He takes all these circumstances, all these trials, all this tragedy, and turns it into something good. That is something you can trust on. And then, as we continue this passage, God starts to use some words here. For those who are called according to his purpose. That simply means those who are his children. And then we come to the next verse. And then he says, for whom he did foreknow, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And moreover, whom he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And whom he justified, he also glorified. And that gets a little bit awkward there, because there's some, you know, Romans 8:28, that's good and encouraging. All things are going to work together for good. Great. All that other stuff about predestined and glorified, and those are big words. And what is that all about? And I want to take a minute here. This is not in the outline in your bulletin, but it's going to be up on the screen. You may want to open up maybe over to John chapter 6 for a moment. And I want to address this real quick, because there are churches that actually split over these issues. And people, they get all in consternation about what the Lord is saying to us here. And so I'm just going to give a quick little thing here. First off, we want to understand three big things about Romans 8:28 through 30. Yes, it's not in your bulletin, but you can scribble on there if you want to. Understand that this passage describes salvation in its fullest sense. What do I mean by that? Back one evening on a Thursday in 1979, I came to know Jesus as my Savior. I was saved that night. I experienced salvation. I entered into a relationship with God. Ever since then, every day of my life, God's been working on me, and he's kind of been saving me every day. Like making me holier, making me more like his son Christ. So in one sense, every day, over in Philippians it says, work out your salvation. That's kind of like exercise. Get your salvation out there. God's going to work in your life, making you more and more like him every day. And then finally, there's a day when you ultimately are saved. The day I ultimately am victorious over sin is the day I walk into glory and am in his presence. And so in one sense, I've been saved. In one sense, I'm being saved. And in one sense, I shall be saved. And it's all true and it's all good. And that's really, in a sense, what this verse, this passage is talking about. That big process. You and I often think of it as a moment in time when I called on Jesus. Very good. Some of y'all been believing all your life. You can't even remember a time when you didn't believe. Praise the Lord for you. And in another sense, he's looking at not just that though, but everything that goes on with that salvation in its fullest sense. Second thing we want to understand, it's describing salvation also from God's point of view. From my point of view, on that day in 1979, some folks from church, from kids from school, had talked to me about the Lord, and God took care of the rest. That night I began to believe. I remember being in my room, I opened up my Bible, I read a verse in the Bible. You've heard me say this before, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I don't know what all happened, but I knew in that moment I believed. God's Word spoke. I don't think it started that night. I think God had been working on me before then. I think God had started bringing us to a place, because we had just moved from the West Coast to Arkansas, and I was going to my second high school in just my third year of high school. I was already at my second one. And here's a group of people that I'd never been in. I'd never been around people like this before, and yet they're the ones that God uses to bring me to Christ. Was that an accident? Was that just probability? Just I was lucky there? No, I think God was working on me. I think God was working around me. I think God was working long before then. Jesus, in speaking to his people over in John 6, he says it kind of like this. All that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. So let's start off here. He says, everyone that the Father gives to me. Some people say, see right there, God sets out some people to be lost and some to be saved. That's not it at all. What he's saying is God's working on us. And the Father, everyone who the Father gives to me is going to come to me. Jesus is working on us. And when He's working on us, when the Holy Spirit's working on us, when the God is working on us, we start getting attracted to Christ. Our eyes become open. We call this conviction of the Holy Spirit. That He starts to open up our eyes to sin and righteousness and judgment. And He says, the ones who come to Me, I'm never going to cast them out. He goes on in John 6, 37 through 39 to say, this is the will of the Father who sent Me, that of all He has given Me, I should lose nothing but should raise it up at the last day. A lot of people want to focus on, see, God gave us to Jesus. He even gave us the capacity to believe salvation is not of ourselves. See, right there it says, God gave us. All right. But in that same John chapter 6, let's move down one more verse, verse 40. This is the will of Him who sent Me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in Him may have everlasting life, and I'll raise him up at the last day. So we've gone from the Father giving us to Jesus, then He flips around and says, and this is God's will. You people are standing here listening to Me. Everyone who sees the Son and believes may have everlasting life. Now they'll still argue and tell you, but God gives you that capacity to believe. Well, I don't really think so. I think that's the one thing God asks for us, is that we believe. He is working on us? Yes. He is bringing us to the point we got a chance to decide? Yes. He has brought you down a path? Yes. And then we go back earlier in the same John chapter 6, and Jesus gets asked a question. What work does God want us to do? They said to Him, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? What do we need to do if we're going to do what God wants us to? What are we going to do? Jesus answered and said, this is the work of God, that you believe in Him whom He sent. This is your end of the... This is the only thing you can do to be saved, and that's believe. This is the work. Because they said to Jesus, what work do we need to do? Jesus could have said, well, I'll give you the capacity to believe. No, that's not what He said. He says, this is what you need to do. Believe in Me. Put your hearts at rest. From God's point of view, He is bringing circumstances. From your point of view, you are suddenly in a spot where there's Jesus. What are you going to do with it? Mike?
Oh, it fell.
Oh. How far back do I have to go? So anyway, the fact is the work that you and I do is that we believe. We're not saved by our good deeds. All I'm believing is that this Jesus lived without sin. He died on that cross. He rose from the grave on the third day. From God's point of view, I've been working on you for a while. You and I might be surprised when somebody comes to know Jesus. You and I might be surprised at who goes into that baptistry to get baptized. But God is not satisfied. He's surprised. He's been working on them for a while. From His point and from your point, it might be two different things, but we're really not so far apart. It's a glorious thing, as we shall see, to know that the Lord is working on me. And the third little point here is all these words like foreknowledge and predestined and called, they're not there to make you wonder and doubt and figure out who's getting saved and who's not. They're there to give you security. This thing about salvation, it doesn't all hinge on you. You and I must believe. Thank the Lord, He's the one who keeps us there. Thank the Lord, He's the one that keeps us secure and wraps us up and doesn't let us go. Thank the Lord that He tells us, oh, this was My plan all along. It's God's will that none should perish, but that everyone should have everlasting life. Everyone come to repentance. And with that, we come into Romans 8, 28, how this thing starts to work together. So we're going to talk about all these big words now. Now, how does Romans 8, 28 come to pass? It starts with this. We read in verse 29, for whom He foreknew, He also predestined. He foreknows. He knew who would respond to His gospel. I can't deny that. I would say he does not set apart these ones to be saved and these ones to be lost. It's simply, I know, if presented with the opportunity, how you're going to respond. How do we know that? That word foreknow is where we get our word prognosticate. And that, again, that's kind of like predicting. It's used in one spot to talk about how God ordained Jesus. Yes, God foreknew that he would ordain Jesus as his son. But most of the time in the New Testament, this word foreknow occurs in spots like this. They knew me from the first. That according to the strictest sense of our sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee, Paul says. That word knew me from the first comes from that word that we get our word prognosticate from. All it means, they've known for a while. Salvation, our relationship with Christ, was never an accident nor plan B. Adam and Eve were in the garden, and the serpent tempted them, and they disobeyed God, and now all of mankind is fallen into this sin nature. What is God going to do? God already knew. This did not catch God by surprise. The events of Eden, he foreknew. He knew beforehand. He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. Now, you can always ask the question, if God knew that would happen, why did he bother? I don't know other than that he loves us and he wanted something to love. God is love, and he wanted something to show that love to, so he made us. And even as failed and frail as we are, it's a great testimony to his love and his grace towards us that he treats us as such. So that word foreknow means yes. He knew beforehand. He knows what you would respond to. You know what? All these people you've been working on trying to lead them to Christ and they don't come. Guess what? God's working on them too. And they are resisting him. They are choosing not to believe. That's the sin that sends someone to hell. The only sin that sends you to hell is choosing not to believe. Here, he's saying, you know what? Even though I don't think they'll believe, even God could say, I know they won't believe. You know what? He loves them so much, he tries anyway. He sends them you. He sends them me. He sends them the missionaries we support, our sister churches. Look, and maybe it's not yet, but God knows. God knows, and God will send people, and God will send the word, and they'll have that opportunity because he knows, and because he loves them. Our second word, so whom he did foreknow, that's those of us who believe, he also predestinates, it says in verse 29. Predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. There's your destiny, determined beforehand. You might like to watch those movies of guys with swords and shields and sorcery and all that, and there's usually one small, weak child there or somebody whose destiny is to be the Savior and the King of them all. His destiny is going to save the land. God's got a destiny for each one of us. I never dreamed when I was 9 years old that God would bring me to Corpus Christi, Texas. I never dreamed when I was... The week before we lived here, I didn't know if you were going to call me or not. And you know, it's amazing the way God does. This still isn't my destiny. It's a spot on the way. What's our destiny? Where does God predetermine each one of us that we are going to wind up? He says, predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. That is your destiny. Everything that happens in your life, the good, the bad, the indifferent, it's making you more and more like Christ. Your destiny wasn't whether you're going to be saved or not. Your destiny is to be like Jesus. In most of these passages where he talks about destiny, he does include this part of the afterlife. Look at this over in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5. Having predestined us to what? Adoptions as sons by Jesus Christ to himself. Our destiny, to be his children. We've talked about this earlier a few weeks ago in Romans chapter 8. It's up on the website. That God adopted each one of us and made us his children. That was back around verse 15, right? And then remember verse 17? If we're children, then we're heirs. heirs with Christ. Our destiny is to be an heir with Christ, to be adopted as Him. It's not setting apart some to be lost and some to be saved. It's not setting apart some destined for heaven and some destined for hell. But what it is our destiny is, this is God's goal with everything, is to make us like Christ. Everything that is going on from salvation, from the word go, was to make us like Christ. It continues in verse 29.
I believe, but it's God who declares me justified. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Who's going to tell us we're not good enough? Who's going to tell us we don't belong? Who's going to tell us a person like you can never be a Christian? It's God who justifies. When the devil tells you, God, okay, I was that bad. But
God is going to take all of that and work something good out of it. Ultimately, it's going to be that you're going to be up there with Him and be like Him. This whole process of salvation is a wonderful thing. It's something God decided to do from the dawn of time and earlier. This whole thing about salvation and God working everything for good is that once you become His, He's molding and making. Your obedience really helps in this. And sometimes your disobedience brings about consequences that, you know what? He has not stopped molding and making. Sometimes bad things have happened to you that are none of your fault. A car wreck, somebody firing you, somebody lying about you, a disease invading your body, and yet in all of that, God is still justifying you, sanctifying you. He's still going to be glorified in you. He's still going to glorify you. None of that stuff means He's stopped. We'll see that next week in our sermon. As we look at all the stuff happening in life, all things work together for good because God's got a purpose. Called according to His purpose. His purpose is what? To have a big old family up in heaven. And the things that happen in this life, the positive, the negative, All of it molds us and makes us into what he's called us to be. Have you ever considered that the tragedy and the trial and the struggle you have gone through are so that there's probably somebody else in this very room that's going through that same thing right now? And they need to know from your testimony that God really will get them through this. In this room, there are probably people who have been abused, people who have had to deal with rebellion and defiance in their children. We have people who have probably gone through many different kinds of diagnosis of diseases that did not give them much hope. We have gone through the pains and struggles of marriage, through divorce, through rejection, through everything you think that is just unique to you. Guess what? In a crowd of about 75 or 80 who are here this morning, someone else has also.
Amen.
God working in every single one of us. Since he has started with you, rest assured he has not stopped. What does that tell you about your Jesus? About the Christ who is reaching out to you this morning? Maybe you're sitting there today and going, you don't know how bad my life's been. And there's a few of you, man, if you started telling us your life story, it's like on a really sad country song, man. Everything has just been wrong and broken for you. Didn't want that Jesus Christ came in. And though the struggle is still there, and the pains and the scars are still there, we found out he's been using and working through me and in me this whole time. He's also preparing me for something that I never dreamed possible. One day I will be glorified. One day I will be like him. That the circumstances are chipping away everything that's not like him. That the struggles and the pains are the things that make me love him more and more. That I have found his grace and his mercy. And maybe some of that that I go through is just simply that I want to be more graceful and merciful than others. Listen and obey.
today could be the day and you could just say, Lord Jesus, I don't understand everything, but I do know that you love me and you're trying to bring me into your family. I want to believe in you start today. I believe you died upon that cross and rose from the grave. Just saying that from your heart. Saying that I'm tired of the old life. I want to hang on to you, Jesus. Right here, right now, that change happens. We're going to pray in a moment. Maybe that's the prayer you want to pray. Maybe that's what you want to express to the Lord. If it is, after you pray, we're going to start singing. When we start singing, maybe you want to come down and tell me about it. Let me pray with you a little more. And maybe you're ready to join and be part of God's family. Maybe your son's been coming to Travis for a while and you're ready to say, hey, I'm already a Christian. I want to be part of the church. While we're singing, we invite you to come down to and share that with them, all right? So let's bow our heads. Our Lord our God, we love you so much. And when we stop and consider what a big, wonderful plan and purpose you have, when we looked at once you came to know us in that bedroom back in 1979, that you weren't going to stop until here we are in 2022 and you're still going. Lord, there's so many in here that can give that testimony. There's some that can say, man, you started last week. Pray your whole day for that. And we know you're going to keep going. Lord, work your purpose in our life and help us to see it. Help that one that's here today to simply say, yes. It's making sense now as you're speaking to me, Lord. I do believe. I do believe that you died for my sins, Jesus, and you rose from the grave. I do believe I want to let you leave my old life behind. I want to start a new life with you, Jesus. I need to be rebuilt, reformed, redeemed. I need my life changed. Right here, right now, Lord, as I pray to you, hear my prayer. Lord, I ask the ones praying like that right now, you give assurance to them and let them know, yes, you did hear that prayer. You see their heart. And you're granting them everlasting life. You're bringing them into the family. And now that you've started, we know, Lord, you're not going to stop. You're going to raise them up at the last day. Thank you, Jesus. We pray all these things in the name of Christ. Amen. So we're going to sing now. As we sing, we invite you to come. Let's all sing.
Sinners poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore, Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love and power. I will arise and go to Jesus. He
starts tomorrow evening. All hands on deck.
together as heirs to the throne. Lord, you have worked in us. You now please work through us, that we may be able to tell others about the gospel of Jesus Christ. How even though we go through long suffering, we know that you are walking beside us. Lord, it is all for the glory of your kingdom. All things work for the good. All things work for the good. Let us not look at the little things that distract us. But Lord, let us understand that we are there for a reason and things happen for a reason. Lord, it is to glorify you. Call us, justify us, and glorify us. Be with us as we leave this place, that our life be shining through you, that we may be there for now.